So we will have one CD, we have one copy of Fearless Change, and then this is a new book for beginners to Agile. I reviewed it and I have a little comment on the back. It's a very good introduction, a summary of the values of Agile. It's called A to XP, the Agile ABC book. So I'm going to put them right here and we'll get the CD, right? Or maybe we're going to play it a little bit after the talk. Okay. All right. Great. So we don't need to look at me, we need to look at this. Asked, can you give us a book that changed your life? And usually the questioner has in mind a book that I might have read or a book that I might have studied. And since I've been asked that question many times, I now have a good answer for it. And the answer is always the same. The book that had the largest impact on my life was not a book I read. It was a book I wrote. This is a book I started writing with my good friend Mary Lynn Manns in 1994. And what we were doing at the time was trying to bring in patterns and Scrum in 1994 into organizations. And as we were doing that, we noticed that we were doing some of the same kinds of things, and we thought these could be patterns. And those patterns have been reviewed, and we've gotten feedback on those patterns from people around the world. They're patterns for introducing ideas into organizations. Now, the book wasn't published until 2005. So in that 10-year period, I went from a person I would describe as a technical person who was a designer, who had a PhD in computer science, master's degrees in computer science and mathematics, bachelor's degrees in chemistry, a very technical person, to all of a sudden being interested in people. And realizing that the world was a lot more complicated than I thought. Wasn't so easy to convince people of good ideas, that it really wasn't related to techniques that I thought I knew about convincing people. So from 2005 until today, I now concentrate on learning more about people and how people think. So I'm going to tell you a few of my favorite patterns from the Fearless Change book, with the hope that maybe I might change your life. In the beginning, well, you have an idea. That's what this book is about. I have an idea. I'd like my team to start doing agile development. I've spent time at this wonderful conference. I have come away with some great ideas. I want to take those back to my organization. How do I do that? The very first pattern, the most important pattern, turns out to be a pattern that was written sort of in the middle of the collection of patterns in this book. It's called Evangelist. Now, the name for that pattern was the result of a struggle between Mary Lynn and me. Mary Lynn still does live in North Carolina, which is in the South. And she said to me in one of our discussions, "Oh, Linda, you don't understand what evangelist means in North Carolina." Well, I was living in Phoenix, Arizona at the time, but I understood what she was talking about. And I said, I think we should look at what the pattern is about. It's about being enthusiastic about a new idea, yes, hence the initial name, Evangelist, but it's also about not really knowing whether your idea is that good or not. You just believe it is. You have faith that it'll help your team or your organization be better. It is about faith. It is about belief. So we kept the name Evangelist. Long after the book was published, we ran across some interesting research on change. So it's a real problem in the United States. People are a little on the chunky side, and we have a high incidence of heart disease. And for many of those people who have heart disease, there comes a time for a serious conversation after a triple bypass or some other surgical adventure. And the doctor in charge will say to the patient, "Now look, you've survived this very complicated surgery, but I'm telling you, if you don't lose weight, start exercising, reduce the stress in your life, you are going to die." That's the message: change or die. Well, it seems pretty simple. I mean, I don't know about you, but if somebody offered me those alternatives, it seems pretty clear, does it not? Change or die? So let's look at the statistics. The people who have been given that message, what percentage are able to change? What do you think? Give me a number. What percentage of people given the message change or die are able to change? Whoa. Well, we have 0%. We have anybody want to go any higher than 0? 5%, 10%? How many? 30%. Change or die, 30%? 100%. Okay, that's a better answer. It's wrong, but it's a better answer. The answer is 10%. Well, what was going on for those other 90%? Were they saying, "Well, I don't know, give up McDonald's? No, I think I'd rather die." Is that what they were thinking? So they began to do some experiments. They said, "We've got to do something about that really bad number." So they did a randomized controlled experiment. Here's the control group. We're going to do nothing to the controls. This group, well, our favorite remedy for anything in the United States is education. Let's have some training. Let's help people understand about good nutrition. Let's help them get started on a good exercise program, maybe some stress reduction. If they're smokers, that's definitely got to go. Education is the key, is it not? So what do you think about the results there of that study? Nothing, education. Any better? Worse? Those of you who were in the tutorial with me on the first day, do you remember the experiment with the prisoners? What was the result? Do you remember? Between the control and education. Do you remember? Yeah, no change. No change, no effect. And that's our standard approach. In the prisoner case, we're trying to prevent repeat offenders, and the success rate is exactly the same as the control. Uh-oh, our favorite remedy, education, doesn't work. So then an interesting fellow named Dr. Dean Ormish, came in and he said, "I think that education stuff is very good, but I think we need to add something. I think I'm going to add some courses, a little bit of hypnosis, some meditation, and my goal is to help those people believe that they can change." Would that hold people back, you think? That they didn't believe that they could change and therefore they couldn't? How many of you were in the stereotyping talk yesterday? Do you remember the Pygmalion effect, where what I believe about you or about myself becomes reality? I create my own reality by my beliefs. Hello, were you awake? Come on. It's late at night. I'm falling asleep up here. Let's go. Come on, get with the program. Yes, yes. Your belief about your abilities or the abilities of others creates the appropriate behavior. So Dean Ormish said, I think we need to tackle it from that angle. We want to help these people believe that they can change and then provide the education that they need to actually change. What do you think about that? Was that effective? Would I be standing up here talking about it if it weren't? Come on. Yes, it was effective. What do you suppose his success rate?
Better than
10. Better than 10. Yes, yes, better than 10. How much better?
50.
Better than 50. 77. 77. And what did he do? He tried to help people believe that they could change. Aha! That's a story now in our collection of known uses for evangelist. What we see in organizational change is many times it's purely a top-down effort. Uh-oh, who said that this week? And it's handed over to somebody who is not an evangelist, who doesn't believe it, who becomes an anointed champion of the cause, and some high-level executive says to this appointed champion, make it happen. And that champion has no belief, does probably, I have known some appointed champions who said, well, the first thing I got to do is find out what this thing is. How can they champion it? They don't have any understanding of what it is or the reason why it would be beneficial for their organization. Hence, most organizational change efforts fail. The leader of the change has to be somebody who has the passion, because remember, if you don't believe in it, it's not going to happen. This is a picture Evelyn used yesterday, and it's one that I've had with me for a long, long time. It's fake, by the way. It looks like an iceberg. It's such a cool picture, but it's not a picture of an iceberg. It's a totally fictionalized creation by somebody who put a bunch of stuff together. But isn't it cool? Isn't it really cool? Yeah. So we know what this is. It's an iceberg. And we also know that the big part of the iceberg is below the surface. Mary this morning was talking about the two systems in the brain. There are lots of models. This is just another way of looking at that. I'm going to say that this is a model of our conscious mind and our unconscious mind. Another word for the same thing. Conscious, well, that's what you, well, most of you are conscious now, I think. Yes? Most of you are conscious now. You are hearing, seeing, thinking, tasting, smelling, creating. Awareness is what you are when your conscious mind is operating. And the rest is unconscious. And it used to be, and this is what Evelyn was telling us yesterday, used to be thought that this was the unconscious. And this part up here was the conscious mind. Well, this model has been around for a long time, and it's changing. We still like to haul it out because the iceberg image is a good one. But I was listening on the way over to one of my favorite podcasts, and the neuroscientist that was being interviewed said, you know that iceberg model? So what we're finding out is that the conscious mind is really, do you see that little snowball up there on the top? So that's the conscious mind. And all the rest is the unconscious. Now the interesting thing about your conscious mind and your unconscious mind is that the cognitive scientists tell us that all that is in all of our decisions are made by the unconscious. And then some kind of signal is sent up to the conscious mind that said, do this. And the conscious mind said, oh, I decided to do this. And I can tell you why. We're very good at that. We're very good at explaining why we decided to do something. But of course, the decision itself was made for reasons that are inaccessible to us. And we can never know why we decided to do anything. He said, you know that iceberg model with the little snowball on the top? He said, the snowball is shrinking. When we try to identify functions of that part of the mind, we find fewer and fewer that we can really pin down as being part of the conscious mind. So the rest of that is where we make decisions. So before I wrote Fearless Change, I thought, well, I'm a smart person, therefore I am rational. I make my decisions on the basis of logic. See that snowball? See? Yep. Since the people I work with in my organization are also smart people, that's how they make their decisions. If I want to influence them, I just need a good, logical argument. Isn't that how it works? Have you tried that lately? Let me explain my idea. Let me show you the benefits. Let me give you a nice logical argument for why we should adopt Agile in our organization. Surely that would be convincing for everyone, would it not? Well, it doesn't seem to work all the time. And what do we do when that fails? Yeah, we say there must be something wrong with those people. They didn't get it. I laid out my nice, rational argument, and they didn't see it. They didn't understand. They didn't realize how good my idea was. I made a lot of mistakes like that. I'm going to try to save you. This is a little bit like the Christmas story. Do you know Dickens, the Christmas story, when Scrooge comes back, and he is sitting in front of his fire, and all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, here comes the ghost of his partner, Marley, saying, Scrooge! Scrooge! I'm here to save you, Scrooge. Well, I'm not dead yet. But that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try to save you from making the same mistakes I did. And that's the first one. Logical argument appeals to that little snowball. That doesn't mean that it's worthless. That just means that you really only have a very small avenue into the brain of the people who are listening to you. It's not much at all. It's hardly anything. What you want to do is grab them in that big, giant, unconscious part. And the way you do that, influence strategies reach the unconscious. So the patterns in fearless change sit on top of a lot of research in cognitive science, all based on influence strategies. We don't have time to go through all of them, but I've just given you one. Evangelist, if you believe and you think it's good, other people pick that up. Other people listen to you, pay attention, because they catch your enthusiasm, because they also might begin to believe. Don't throw away that logical argument, but it's just not so important. There's another fundamental error that we make about our ideas, and that is when we get caught up in the notion of goodness. Wait, we'll take a poll now. How many believe that good triumphs over evil? Oh my goodness. Always? Is that always the case? Always. Most of the time. Okay. And in the end. You mean when the sun burns out and the earth is destroyed? Oh, when the long, well, how long? How long? Oh, it doesn't matter. I see. So will it be within my lifetime? I'm running out up here. Or in a future life. Okay. I would just wonder, can you think of a time in history when there were ideas on the table? Clearly, one of them was pretty bad. And that's the one that won. Okay, so at least for the people who were murdered under that regime, we should say, well, just wait around. I mean, okay. Wow. I think you should come up here, and I should go. So that's an interesting take on good ideas and bad ideas. I'm going to have to process that when I'm a little more awake, but it's a fundamental flaw, in our thinking. It's a cognitive bias. It's called the just world hypothesis, that we do all believe in that. We really do, the people who raised their hands. And it will get in the way. Like some of those cognitive biases I talked about in estimation, if it's a belief in goodness, and we believe our ideas are good ones, then sometimes that gets in the way. We think, I'll explain my good idea, and since they are logical, and they will see the goodness and good new ideas. So you need some more patterns. And when you use the patterns, I can't remember where I heard this in the last couple of days, talking about organizational change as though you could plan it. You could lay it out, a strategy for change. And what we know is that we and our organizations are complex adaptive systems, and changing those is very difficult. And you certainly can't do it according to plan, because any time you tweak it or move it or blow in its ear, it will move in unexpected ways. So all you can ever do are little tiny small things, and then stand back and watch and say, well, how did that work? Kenji showed us a wonderful video today in his session about an attempt at organizational change where an initial step was pretty broad and sweeping, and it didn't work so well. And finally they said, wait, back up a little bit. Let's just try a small thing and learn from that, and maybe make some adjustments along the way. And then let's talk about the next step and the next step. It's a series of small steps. This is also called the Kolb learning cycle. Try it, test the waters, try some small thing, stop, think about it. That's time for reflection. And then look at what is working, and on the basis of that, take the next small step. That's agile development, by the way. Each iteration, you put it out there, you stop, you say, how's that working? What's working well? You carry forward, rinse, repeat. Don't jump into massive you can't anyway. Even in throughout history, if we look at massive changes, if you pick those up and shake them out, you'll see that they're the end result of a lot of very small steps that at some point might have reached the tipping point, and then the rock begins to roll down the hill. But you don't know when that's going to happen, and you certainly cannot plan it. So here's another pattern. It's called the right time. And when we wrote it, we realized that if your team is under a lot of pressure and getting ready to deliver, that is not the time to bring in your new idea to say, hey, why don't we try this? My friend Mary Lynn is an academic, and she knows that when you're getting ready for final exams, faculty members don't want to hear about some new idea. But now, we see this pattern is bigger than that. How many of you know Tom DeMarco? He wrote a lot of really interesting books, and one of them is called Slack. Read that? Yeah. In Slack, he says that if organizations are to change, there's a little bit of upheaval, there's a learning curve, people get discouraged, there's a time for adjustment in there, and if your organization has no slack, wait, does that translate? Do you know what I mean when I say slack? Yeah, okay. If your organization has no slack, it cannot learn. So this pattern not only says, well, sure, you watch the timing of the introduction of your new idea, but what I see, most organizations around the globe now have no slack. Everybody's under a lot of pressure and a lot of stress, and even though they're smart and well-intentioned, they just can't make any kind of change because they don't have any room to breathe. I remember when I went to work for a little startup company after I had written the book, and I started talking immediately about patterns and let's try some Scrum and wouldn't you like to experiment with all these things, and everybody was so enthusiastic. I started giving brown bag talks over lunch. Oh yeah, Linda, come on, tell us about these patterns. And let's think about daily stand-up. Yeah, shorter iterate. Let's do it. And nothing, absolutely nothing happened. I thought, oh no, you mean these patterns don't work? Whew, don't tell anybody. Please, don't tell anybody. Wasn't that at all. It was that this pattern is more important than we realized. That if the organization doesn't have any time to breathe, time to say, okay guys, we're going to take a couple of weeks here and we're going to try Scrum, or we're going to start looking at patterns, or we're going to learn a new program, whatever it is, it needs a time for that change to take place. So I thought Tom DeMarco's warning was pretty severe. If you don't have any slack, your organization can't learn. And you know what? These patterns don't just work at the organizational level. They also work at the personal level. So what I just said about organizations, that applies to you. If you want to change your own life somehow, you want to give up smoking, you want to lose weight, you run a marathon in June, you want to learn a new programming language, you want to go to a conference, whatever it is, you're going to have to believe you can do it. Build step by step whatever it is that you want to reach. And if you don't have any time to adjust to whatever the new thing is, you won't be able to learn. You won't be able to change either. So often I talk to people who are trying to change their organizations and they say, well, okay, I believe I've got the evangelist pattern down, and so what should I do next? And I said, well, you know, you've got a lot of alternatives here for your test the waters pattern, but here are two of my favorites. The first one says, why don't you just find something? And I've talked to at least a half a dozen people at this conference who said, my organization is so dysfunctional. My manager won't listen to me. My boss, my team, my. It's a lot of whining. Weren't we going to give that whinging award? Where was that? I can't remember what talk. Yeah, I have a lot of nominations for that whinging award. Because isn't that easy? It's so easy to make up an excuse for why you can't do something. Well, those people are holding me back. So the just do it pattern says there's always something you can do. Sometimes it's walk out the door. And that should be a decision you should consider. If it's not working for you, and I can't remember where that came up, maybe that was at the panel this morning. Get the heck out of there. Go somewhere where you can be happy, where you can do what you want to do, where you can be what you want to be. Don't just sit and whinge. Do it. But if you're going to stay, realize the message of the pattern is there is always some small thing you can do. I don't care how dysfunctional, because I have seen the insides of many of those dysfunctional. In fact, I've been in many of those as an employee. Oh my God, I got stories. There is always some small thing you can do. And that's true at the personal level. Well, I can't possibly do it. My wife won't let me, my kids, I got my mother. I had a friend once who said, I really want to learn Italian, but I have to wait until my mother-in-law dies. Your mother-in-law has to die before you can learn Italian. She said, yes, because I'd have to take lessons. And in order to have the lessons, well, I'd have to go outside the home and I'd have a babysitter for my kids. And my mother-in-law would find out about it. And she would give me no end of hell for leaving my kids with a babysitter. So I have to wait until she dies. Okay, she's a good friend of my friend Susan, who's been married 5 times, by the way. Just do it. Just do it. You can find some small way to just do it. And that's a little tiny step. And those of you who were in my tutorial on Monday or Tuesday or whenever that was, know that if you take the first small step, that's the commitment influence strategy. And you're more likely to find the next step and the next step. And that's true at the organizational level as well as the personal level. Ah, here's my favorite pattern, and I'm going to try to talk fast now so that we can have some dinner. Do food! Yay! I live in the United States. We are the fattest nation on the face of the earth. Let's hear it. We're number one. And even there, food is a powerful influencer. I was on a team once that had a scout. When we got a meeting notice, the scout would go ahead to see if they were going to have cookies at the meeting. And then he would report back to the team, are they having cookies? And if they are, what kind of cookies? We're not going if it's oatmeal raisin. It's got to be chocolate chip. Now, these are guys who could afford to buy all the cookies they want. Why the lure of free chocolate chip cookies? What is it? It's a hardwired something we have carried with us for thousands of years. It's the notion that food brings people together. You might not be aware of it, of course, and right now you're saying, oh no, that doesn't work for me, but it does. Many languages even have a word for friend that has to do with food. The one that comes to mind first is French, compagnon. Someone with whom I break bread is my friend. And of course, if we go back far enough, the only people we shared food with while we were sitting in a circle out in the savannah were our friends and family. And there's a lot of us that's still sitting out there under the trees in the savannah. I don't know if you noticed your boss every now and then. He's knuckles dragging on the ground. He's got a lot of hair on his back. Yeah, it's not so long ago. And all those tendencies that we had, we still have with us. And some of those are extremely powerful. And this one, more so than most. Not to say that it doesn't have downsides. We know people are watching their weight. We know people have different preferences. That's why you have to know your own context. So when we introduced that pattern in Ireland, they said, no, no, Linda, no chocolate chip cookies. No, here's how it is. You go out to the pub after work and you buy the first round and then you talk about patterns or agile development. Yeah. So you have to know your own context for whatever the food is. When do you do it? Over lunch? After work? That's up to you. But the power of food and or drink speaks to that lower part of the iceberg. Do food. What we know is that when you talk to anybody about agile development or patterns or whatever it is that you're trying to sell, because that's what this is, it's sales. We're a little uncomfortable about that, aren't we? Sales. Isn't that what the business guys do? Marketing and sales. We wouldn't want to have anything to do with those people, would we? Oh no, not us. Do you know Dan Pink, the name Dan Pink? He wrote the book called Drive. He's got another book out now. It's called To Sell is Human. And the crux of the book is something that I realized finally after I wrote Fearless Change, is that we are all in sales. Not only are we selling our ideas, when we have a good idea, we need to learn how to sell it, but we sell ourselves all the time. And if you don't have a toolbox with some good influence strategies and some good sales techniques, then you are hurting yourself. Remember me? Remember I'm saying, Scrooge. Don't make the mistake I did, believing for over 50 years that the world should know how good I am. I don't have to sell myself. The world should understand my capabilities. I taught at university for a while, and I remember my department chair came to see me one day, and he said, Linda, you want to try this new class, software engineering. Ooh. That'll be the first time it's offered this semester, so you better get out and sell it. Sell? Moi? Everybody knows how good I am. Everybody knows my courses are good. I should not have to sell. Big mistake. Don't you make that mistake. You want to learn all the sales techniques you can, not only for your good ideas, but for yourself. So when you're selling, people are thinking one thing. As you're telling them about your wonderful new idea, they have one question in that little snowball up there, their conscious mind. What is that one question? Yes, what's in it for me? And is the answer to that question the same for every person you talk to? No. So if you're going to tell a developer or a tester or your team lead or a manager or an executive or somebody on the business side about agile development, are you going to do that in exactly the same way? No, you're not. Is it going to take the same amount of time? Are you going to cover the same points, the same benefits? Does the CEO care about a lot of things that testers care about? Absolutely not. So when you're thinking about selling, remember the pattern personal touch, which says every person is looking for something different, and you better find out what it is if you're going to grab a hold of them by that big chunk of iceberg where they make their important decisions. And not just give them the canned outline of what agile development is all about. And it better be short, it better be sweet, and it better be to the point. Don't waste their time, and don't tell them too much. It's another pattern, but we don't have time for everything. One of the problems you're going to run into with the personal touch pattern is that you're going to believe that for some reason everybody should be equally enthusiastic about new ideas. And the research of E.M. Rogers shows clearly that is not the case. He said, in any moment in the introduction of a new idea, people are going to react in one of a number of ways. Those people who get excited about it because they think it's the latest and greatest thing, well, you can tell them anything. We call them the low-hanging fruit. His word was innovator. So all you have to do is say, hey, I went to this cool conference and I heard a lot of cool people and they were talking about this new cool stuff called agile development, and the innovator will say, yippee, let me at it, I want to do it, sign me up. That's it. Easy. Look how small that percentage is. Do you see that? 2.5. Oh, this is in a normal population, which I have never seen, by the way. 2.5%. There could be organizations that have a lot of innovators. There could be organizations that have none. You have to know your own organization. Early adopters like your logical argument, your PowerPoint slides. They love data. They want to learn more. But look at that percentage, oh my gosh, 13.5, not so good. What do other people think? The early majority. The early majority wants to know what other people are doing, especially other people just like them. So the first question they will ask is, you say this is new and cool, agile development, who else is doing it? Is IBM or fill in the blank your favorite company, are they doing it? It's like my brother-in-law, you know, would not buy any kind of a phone where you had to touch it with your finger. He just wouldn't do that. Until my cousin got one, and then he said, oh, well, I guess maybe I should have one. early majority. Well, yeah, what do other people think? If I have to, late majority. So I worked on the 777 airplane, the 777. It was all done in the programming language Ada. They hated it. Well, it was a big organizational change. And I heard that over and over. I have to. I guess I have to. Late majority. Uh-oh, there's one more. We've always done it this way. It's the best. The laggards. So here's a question I get asked by managers all the time. How can I identify those people? I can identify any of them. How can I identify them? So the idea is, of course, if, you know, maybe they had a hologram implant in their forehead, said, innovator, I'm a capital I, that they could perhaps eliminate. I mean, wouldn't that be the idea? That you could eliminate those people at the bottom, those people? You could eliminate those people. Wouldn't that be a good idea? Let's just get rid of... I can remember somebody asking me a long time ago in the mid-90s, they said, well, you know, we got this one guy, and he will not pair. Should we fire him? I said, well, is he any good? I mean, does he know anything? Does he work hard? Why'd you hire him in the first place? Just because he won't pair, that doesn't mean you should fire him if he adds value. I think we need to be careful about saying, well, these people won't play, so let's just get rid of them. And the reason I say that is that over my career, I have seen a lot of things come and go. And there were a lot of times when I thought that, let's just get rid of these people because they won't learn this new thing. And now, pretty soon, you find you're in that category. We've always done it this way. What do you mean we're going to have a new programming language and a new environment? And is it? I have a good friend who just retired because she said, I don't have another system change in me. I can't do it. She's a physician, very nice lady, very smart, but they're changing all their record-keeping systems in the hospital. She said, I can't go through another one. So those people at the bottom, they get smashed when they might be very good people who add value. What you need to do sometimes is listen and learn. Was that applause back there? Thank you. All right, thank you. I ran into a guy at a conference just recently. He said, hey, Linda, I got your book, Fearless Change. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. He said, I read all those patterns. Wow, that's nice. He said, I tried them all out. They don't work. Well, I'm always happy to get feedback. So I said, tell me about that. Well, what happened? So he started talking. And as I was listening to him, I started having a vision. And it was of a man on a white horse riding in to an organization. And he was saying, listen up, all you people. I know the one true way. I am your savior. I will lead you out of darkness into the light. I know you, the great unwashed, don't understand how important this idea is, but I will help you. Trust me. I don't know why he wasn't successful. It's easy when you believe, it's easy to cross the line from evangelist to fanatic. It's easy to cross the line from believing in a good idea because you think it will help others to being the Savior, the one and only who knows the way. The remedy for that is to involve others. In fact, again, as those of you who took the class on influence strategies know, the most convincing thing you can do to someone else is to say, I need your help with this. Could you help me? Would you pair with me? Would you help me write this document? Would you like to help me give a presentation? Would you? And when someone else is involved in the new idea, then they begin to own a little piece of it. And the more pieces you can distribute, the greater will be your influence. You gain power by giving it away. Seems kind of obvious, but no more obvious than the next pattern that goes with it. And we almost didn't put it in the book because we thought, well, yeah, okay, the pattern says, you're asking for help from all these people. Remember to say thank you. Seems so obvious. So I sent some email, we got some reviewers, and we said, what do you think? Should we have this pattern called Just Say Thanks? What do you think? Got a lot of email, and most of it said something like the following. You know, last weekend was my son's birthday, but I had to come in and work. So we're having this problem with the database, and we had a customer demo coming up on Monday. I mean, I had to fix it. I worked all weekend on that thing. I did get it fixed. And you know what? I don't mind that. I love my job. I love solving problems. I love helping people. But nobody on my team, not my team leader, not my manager, nobody said, hey, I know you were here all weekend. I know you missed your son's birthday, but you got that database running for the customer demo. Thanks for that. We left it in. And at the time, we thought, well, it's a good thing, isn't it? I say thank you, and you feel better. But the research around saying thanks is interesting because it's backwards. If I go around as an appreciative person, and I tend to notice what other people do and appreciate them and say thanks, I get the benefit. People who live lives of gratitude live longer. Sign me up. Have fewer colds. Are more successful. So I'd just like to take this opportunity to say thanks to all of you. I know you probably could have gone home early. You know you're not going to get any dinner until the talk is over. But you did have choices and you decided to stay here with me until 8:30 at night. I really appreciate that. Thanks.